You know, as a person, I've liked some controversial things in my time. To give you a couple examples, I like The Office. That's a continuous thing. I've played Yandere Simulator and kind of enjoyed it. I know there's major controversy going on, but I didn't pay for it. And I kind of like the gameplay. I think it's very funny, and that's very fucked up of me, and I understand that. Okay? Also, one of the other things that I've liked is Your Boyfriend, like the game. It's an 18 plus game, by the way, and it's been made by Inverted Mind Inc. I've played it all the way through. I've even made art for it. Gonna be honest, super controversial. But nothing is more controversial than goddamn Creepshow art. And you know what? I'm breaking my policy because 3 days ago, and by the way, my policy is that I don't swear in videos. But you know what? Fuck it. I'm breaking my policy. Because you know what happened after, like, literally radio silence for, like, 3 months, maybe more? Creepshow art blasts onto the goddamn scene with the hottest of takes, which I'm going to sum up here. She says, blatantly, I am not a stalker. I did not stalk Emily Artful. And by the way, here are some images that I found on her very old DeviantArt from over 8 years ago, just to prove that I'm not a stalker and that she also had a crush on her teacher. I don't know if you can see how weird that makes me feel, but hey, if you want to prove you're not a stalker, maybe don't stalk people! How the hell do you not get this right, Creepshow? Jesus! Anyway, I'm Bargety, and welcome back to my channel. If you like my content, remember to like, subscribe, comment. Oh, and also, tell me what your favorite kind of food is. I'm kind of interested. Anyway, let's get into the meat and potatoes of this thing, because I am beyond floored at the audacity of Creepshow art. Let's get into it. All right. So Creepshow makes a 2 hour long, 2 hour and 30 minute long documentary about how she is innocent. She has to be innocent. She has all this proof. And for me, I was curious, first of all, because if there's one thing I want to see from people who are accused of doing terrible things, I want to give them the benefit of the doubt. So what I do is if they want to provide me proof, I am eager to listen. That makes a lot of sense. You have to be able to give people the benefit of the doubt, even if it seems improbable, you know? Emily herself presented a lot of evidence. She even did screenshots from her own phone. She went into 2 videos and a Twitter thread, and there might be something she got wrong there. The human memory is very fuzzy, but you know what you can't really, like, mistake or misinterpret? It's screenshots. Screenshots of what exactly was said at the time. And Emily had those. And what I'm excited about is the idea of proof that Creepshow had something to defend herself with. Either conflicting screenshots or maybe even a full set of other ones. Maybe her and Anthony have something else. But that's not what this 2 hour long waste of time was. The first thing I'm going to address is the idea that Emily is quote-unquote Amy. And although I do find very weird similarities between them, I do think Creepshow is lying about Emily not being Amy in some weird way. I know that Creepshow wants to put in that she knew this girl in high school and she never knew Emily in high school, therefore they're completely different people. The thing is, you can lie about someone. And honestly, I don't think Creepshow is above lying about someone. I said I'd give her the benefit of the doubt. I didn't say I would give her full dignity on lying, okay? But to prove this, in like a 5 second clip near the end of her documentary, that's what I'm calling it now, she says, oh, and to prove that Amy isn't Emily and I was stalked, I am going to show you some screenshots of emails that me and Amy had shared with each other, which does nothing except for expose this kid you went to high school or middle school with as a stalker. Creepshow was just like, and here's my stalker. Here's her face and these cringy ass emails that we used to send to each other. And here's the thing, if Creepshow was really stalked, which there is some doubt, but stalking is no joke. It is terrifying to happen. You never feel safe. You never feel perfectly clean. Like, that kind of shit is traumatizing, you know? And if Creepshow was stalked by this girl, Amy. Honestly, I kind of feel tremendously horrible, but at the same time, if this is all made up, Creepshow might have potentially exposed, like, a former friend of hers as being a stalker, and anybody who would have known Creepshow in high school or middle school is now going to think of that person as a stalker and possibly take action. That is terrible. But also, in your I am a stalker video, or not I am a stalker, Freudian slip, in the I was stalked for 8+ years video, Creepshow mentions something very specific. She says that her and her stalker are friends now. And also, when the locale thing, that's what set it off, Creepshow says that her stalker was spoofing her IP. But that means that Creepshow must have her email, or at least an email history, like, at all. Like, you must have something, right? Surely, after you've made the my stalker stalked me for 8+ years and now we're friends video, surely you wouldn't be deleting things again, right? You wouldn't do that. You wouldn't just delete the emails, right? After you said that you were no longer gonna do that because you need proof just in case it happens again, you wouldn't delete the evidence so we couldn't see it. But that obvious lie aside, let's get into Tipster. Now, Tipster's videos were very informative. I'm going to link them down below, but that's the thing. Tipster's videos were very informative. They went over the allegations pretty fairly. He explained why he didn't exactly trust Creepshow at the time. He explained that he reached out to her. He was very transparent, showed screenshots, talked about it a lot. And you know what? I think that's very fair of him to go out. And when Creepshow said, "Hey, don't defend me," he didn't do that because he cared about what people would think of his reputation, which is fair. He's a YouTuber. And more importantly, he's an info YouTuber. So what he says matters. People will go to him looking for facts about current situations, and that is important to him. That's his whole brand. So when Creepshow said, "Hey, don't defend me," and Tipster replied back, "If you have any evidence to the contrary, please let me know so I can help you out," Creepshow comes back onto the scene with this 2-hour-long clip, and she basically says, "Fuck you, I never needed your friendship, and also, I'm gonna be a total brat about this because..." And she doesn't give an explanation. She presents all this quote-unquote evidence. Again, I'll go into how shit I think the evidence is. But she presents all this quote-unquote evidence, and then she tells Tipster to go fuck himself. Weird 180 turn to somebody who is apparently your friend. Oh, but I forget, Creepshow doesn't have friends, because she talks shit about them on locale. And you know what? That's not speculation. We can prove it. We've actually seen full-on evidence that she was, at the time, posting the locale and talking shit about all of her friends, who she no longer has, because guess what? When you're shitty, you don't deserve friends. I know that it's a hot take to say if you're shitty, you don't deserve friends, but you know what, Creepshow? You're shitty and you don't deserve friends. Real love to Tipster, though. Go check out his videos after this one. The third thing that I'm going to go into is the sibling drama between Creepshow and her sibling. Her sibling is non-binary. I'm not going to provide any ads, links, or even screenshots that lead directly to her sibling's profile, because her sibling has been harassed relentlessly and even doxxed by Creepshow herself. So what we're gonna do is we're just gonna leave Creepshow's sibling out of this. But another thing that Creepshow accuses her sibling of doing is taking money all the time, accusing Creepshow of being really pro their cousin, who Creepshow refers to as her brother, and there's nothing wrong with that. But Creepshow's sibling did a lot to expose Creepshow's kind of inner workings, especially how she treats trans people on the daily, which links back to the locale thing where she was using transphobic and homophobic slurs a lot. But then it reaches all the way back to how Creepshow, in her most authentic life, offline, off locale, off YouTube, treats her own sibling, who probably just wants to be respected in their own identity. But Creepshow continues to refer to her sibling as female, even though they clearly aren't. And those are just the people that aren't Emily that are addressed in this 2-hour and 30-minute long shit show. So buckle up, we're not even a page into the script. So let's start at kind of the beginning of the chronological timeline here. The DeviantArt thing is certainly weird. Creepshow drags up images that Emily had made of her teacher in very uncomfortable positions, to be perfectly honest. Basically, pseudo and suggestive images of her teacher. Not cool, a little cringy, super not okay, to be perfectly honest. But you have to take into the context that Emily was a child. And children will do things to elicit attention anywhere they can get it. And having a crush on your teacher, there's nothing wrong with that as long as they don't reciprocate those feelings, because they're an adult and you're a child. And the thing is, Emily being a child and showing this kind of weird hormonic desire for her teacher is not exactly out of the ordinary. But you know what is out of the ordinary? Digging up somebody's past to the point where you find their DeviantArt images from over 8 years ago and then bringing it up in a documentary style video to frame them as a bad person because they looked at their teacher and said, "Hey, I have a crush on that," and then bringing it up literally over 8 years later to do what exactly? Like, are you trying to slander Emily by showing that she had weird feelings for a teacher when she was young? Or are you just doing this to prove that you're not a stalker? Because I've got some news. If you're trying to prove that you're not a stalker, maybe going through somebody's entire internet history and then going into something that they posted on DeviantArt 8+ years ago, maybe, and this is just a thought, maybe you are a stalker. Just saying. Think about it. The next thing I want to talk about is something that Emily has addressed heavily, and that is that Emily used to be a pick-me, which, if you don't know what a pick-me is, it's a kind of girl that acts misogynistic so that men will like her better than others and then choose to date them instead of other girls, basically. You know those I'm not like other girl posts? It's those, but a person. Creepshow shows several screenshots of Emily being generally misogynistic on her Twitter, calling women fat or pigs, which is super disrespectful. But Emily Artful brings it up actually in her first video about Creepshow art, explaining that, yeah, she was a pick me. She was problematic. She said terrible things to other women in order to garner male attention faster than other people. And that's the thing, she addresses this. You can have problematic takes in your past. The important thing is to do what Emily did and pull those things to the foreground and explain that those things are no longer what your values are. And even though those things are part of Emily's past, her ability to acknowledge them and point out why and how they were wrong and inappropriate in that time is very important for growth. And now going to another thing that I feel like absolutely nobody should know on the internet about influencer, especially one that just wants them to be left alone, basically. So now I have to address it because it was in the Creepshow art video, but I'm only going to do it briefly because I don't think it damages her character in any way. Emily Artful used to be a cam girl. She addresses this herself, and it is a fact that she used to be a cam girl. Creepshow art uses this against her as showing that Emily might have a devious past with being in this career, which is not true. There is literally no correlation, and I think it is super offensive for Creepshow to point out how misogynistic and terrible Emily Artful's old tweets were, where she was being kind of a pick-me, and then turning around and saying, "And also, Emily Artful was a cam girl at one point, and that makes her character bad." I think that is hypocritical and the worst hot take you could ever think of. Garbage sauce. And then Creepshow Art brings up that Emily was lying about being a model, which is not true. Literally at any point in your life, you can say that you are a model. You don't have to be associated with an agency. You don't even have to work for anybody. But you can say that you are a model at any time, and you can work for yourself, and you can be a model, and that is not lying. Creepshow claims that Emily Artful has been lying about being a model in her earlier careers, and Creepshow Art is in fact lying. That is a fact. It's not an opinion, that is a fact. Creepshow Art lies. Creepshow Art also goes into Emily Artful's sobriety. yet another thing that I think I have literally no business knowing, but since Emily Artful has mentioned it, and so has Creepshow Art, her sobriety is in fact something that is on the table now. Emily Artful used to be an addict. And there is absolutely... There is things that are wrong with that. Addiction is a very serious illness that a lot of people can suffer from. There are issues with being involved with drugs and also the lifestyle surrounding drugs that can lead you into a massive depressive spiral. And I'm not saying that Emily went through any of that, but it does sound like Emily had a hard time in this part of her life where she was addicted to drugs and she was trying to get over it and get out of her situation where drugs were dependency. And honestly, people who hold on to their sobriety are incredible. They are so strong. And Creepshow bringing up the validity of her sobriety is honestly the rudest fucking thing I think I've ever heard from anybody. Because Creepshow herself has said that she knows addict. She's been an addict. Actually, I don't think she ever says that she's been an addict, but she knows an addict. Her parents met in AA. She knows all this shit. She pretends that she knows all this shit firsthand, but really, Emily Artful has been an addict, and she got over it, and thank God she did, because that kind of lifestyle can actually kill you. Drug abuse can kill you. It's traumatizing. It's a terrible thing to go through, especially when you feel so alone and somebody is stalking you, Creepshow. That is the absolute worst thing you can do to somebody, is question their sobriety, even though they don't even fucking owe us that. They don't owe us an explanation for their sobriety. You don't even need to know how long she has been sober. You don't have to bring in the validity of any of that shit. But you know what? You brought it up, so now I'm yelling about it. And I'm so sorry. I'm gonna calm down for a second. Anyway, my point is that Creepshow lies about Emily's sobriety, or the validity of her sobriety, and I think that that is not very cash money. Okay, next thing. The next thing that's less of a push-button topic, I guess, is that to prove something, not sure what, this is a lot of things that Creepshow does. She shows evidence of something, and she alludes to the fact that it proves that she didn't do anything wrong, but she never explains how it proves it. So anyway, Creepshow brings up the harassment that Emily Artful went through when she was actually a channel called Sugarfruit, which, cute name, but this whole channel was all about reviewing anime. She did one review in a bathtub, which is fine. A weird place to do an anime interview, I'll admit it, but it's fun. You can do an anime review wherever you like. And the thing is, a lot of people at the time were very upset with her. Mostly men, gonna be honest, because men have the worst takes on things. LOL. But anyway, Emily does a review of, I think, One Piece in her bathtub. Men pick up on this, and they just start harassing her about it, claiming that the only reason she did it was because she wanted to garner men's attention, because she was in a bathtub, she's a very attractive woman, so it would be better, like, views-wise for her. And if she did, get that bag. If she didn't, then that's not for me to say. But here's the thing, reviewing a anime while you're in the bath, not a crime, doesn't prove that you didn't stalk anyone. Creepshow. And anyway, she just shows over 15 minutes of people yelling at Emily. I think for just proof that people have harassed her in the past, but that doesn't prove that Anthony and Creepshow didn't harass her. It just shows that Emily has had a lot of weird trauma on the internet, and it has to be addressed in this weird 2-hour and 30-minute documentary for some reason, because Creepshow apparently just wanted to stuff all of the shit in there that she could, because she has actually no evidence, no screenshots, no emails, no nothing. She has no evidence, so she buffers for time by showing other people's videos of them being kind of mad about a woman reviewing anime in a bathtub. Another thing that Creepshow brings up, which I think is kind of invalid, is that Emily describes her past relationships as always kind of ending in a kind of friendly way, except for two. Those being Seth, a man who cheated on her, and Anthony, someone who honestly has been kind of a blight on her life. I don't blame her for not being friendly. But instead of addressing that, of course, because Anthony is terrible, Creepshow goes into a long spiel about how it's not true. How Anthony has described Emily's exes as being really mad at her and kind of bad, you know? And I think that's a lie. I'm calling Anthony a liar, and you can come at me. The second last thing I want to bring up is how Creepshow always pretends that Emily trying to be an influencer and pretending that nothing is wrong with her life while being outwardly on the internet and getting popular. Creepshow likes to pretend that just because she's doing that means that she never once feared for her life from Anthony or Anthony's friend or even Creepshow herself. She likes to pretend that Emily wanted to do a meet and greet once because she was having a good time, but this was allegedly after, like, Anthony had threatened her. And, it's called pretending nothing's wrong. So that you can try and move on with your life. So you can have these pockets of happiness within your life that don't have anything to do with your weird psycho stalker, okay? And pretending that everything's okay while you interact with your fans, because if people knew that you were being stalked, all of a sudden, you would have a weird controversy on your goddamn hands. But you know what, Creepshow? That's just my opinion, apparently. And also, it's a lot of other people's opinions, because that's how people act. When people are scared, they like to pretend that they're not, in order to just shield themselves, even temporarily, from the idea of fear, okay? And I'm not gonna blame Emily for that, because that would be super weird. Also, Creepshow in this documentary constantly explains that Anthony's stalking, harassing, bullying, and threatening Emily online wasn't her, wasn't Creepshow, therefore didn't happen. And I understand you're only able to speak for yourself, and Anthony's voice on this is actually something that I would love to hear. I would love to see if he has any screenshots. But just because you didn't stalk, harass, threaten on Twitter, claim that somebody didn't make their views, truthfully or honestly, just because you didn't harass or be weird to, just because you didn't do that, doesn't mean your husband did, okay? I know that you love him or whatever, but love doesn't shield you from all things. It just doesn't work that way. Anthony, being in the middle of this controversy, who hasn't spoken, instead he's gotten his wife to speak for him. He's just stayed in the background this whole time, and he doesn't want to address any of this. And I think it's because if Anthony spoke up about this, we would start to find all kinds of holes, because that's how he acts. I feel like he lies to both. And the thing is, Creepshow, if truly you weren't doing any of this, if none of the stalking came from you before this video, if you absolutely knew nothing about it and you didn't mean to do anything, you never interacted with her in any unsavory way, that's fine. If you're not the stalker in this scenario, I really want to know. Like, I really want to know who it is. Because I think it's Anthony. And that's just a theory. A game theory. As always, everything stated in this video is my opinion, and my opinion only. I bring these things up because the allegations are getting staggering, and Creepshow is doing nothing to help herself. So, that's my opinion, and, you know what? I'm signing off. Everyone, stay safe out there, and be careful, okay? Don't forget to like, subscribe, and comment on the video if you liked it. It really helps the algorithm. And, you know what? Leave a comment. I know I asked you for your favorite food earlier, but I really need to know what you guys think of this situation. If you disagree with me, that's fine. I would love to hear your side of the story as well. And